In this video, I'm going to show you how you can use SPI to communicate between a Raspberry Pi and an Arduino. I'll be showing a practical example using Python on the Raspberry Pi and C++ on the Arduino, with an example test environment with code that you can use in your next project. I'm going to start by explaining what SPI is, why you may want to use it instead of the traditional serial protocol, and I'll cover how you can handle the difference in voltage between the Raspberry Pi GPIO and the Arduino, and a simple data protocol that I've created for this example. So I'm going to start with the theory about SPI. If you're already familiar with that and would like to move straight onto the practical section, then look for the chapters on the timeline or in the description. But first, I'm going to talk a little about the language and terminology I'm going to use. Traditionally, SPI has been explained in terms of a master-slave relationship. This is now considered by many to be inappropriate, as it is trivialising the suffering of slaves, both historically and through modern-day slavery, affecting vulnerable people around the world. Also, the terminology isn't really correct. Whilst SPI is often used to connect to basic devices, which just respond to requests, we will be using an Arduino, which is programmable. And whilst the Raspberry Pi will be controlling the communication bus, it's equally possible for the Arduino to instruct the Raspberry Pi to do something. It doesn't need to be just one way. So on that basis, referring to a master-slave doesn't really make sense. I'm therefore going to refer to the Raspberry Pi as the main device, or main controller, and the Arduino used, in this example, as a secondary device. There's other terminology that could be used, but using words that begin with M and S allow it to fit in with the usual acronyms, which you will see later. With that out of the way, I can now explain how SPI works. It's a serial protocol similar to the UART USB serial communications which I used in a previous video. However, SPI is a synchronous communication protocol, which means that it needs a clock signal. It's also normally used in a full-duplex bidirectional mode, whereas in the UART-based serial communication previously, the data was sent in a half-duplex, sending only one direction at a time. So first I'll look at the UART serial communications, then show how this differs for how SPI works. The UART is actually the name of the hardware rather than the protocol. It stands for Universal Asynchronous Receiver and Transmitter. But to make it easier to understand, I'll use UART when talking about the protocol, normally used via USB. On the Raspberry Pi, the UART is also available on the GPIO ports 14 and 15, physical pins 8 and 10. And on the Arduino Uno on physical pins 0 and 1. Excluding the ground connection, which is needed for all communications, there are two connections between the Raspberry Pi and the Arduino. The transmit from the Raspberry Pi goes to the receive of the Arduino, and the transmit from the Arduino goes to the receive of the Raspberry Pi. The information is sent from the transmit of one device to the receive of the other, shown here going from the Raspberry Pi to the Arduino. If the Arduino would like to send information back, then it takes its turn to send data on its transmit port, which is received at the Raspberry Pi. This happens asynchronously, which means there is no need for an external clock, and is normally half-duplex, meaning that one side takes it in turns at transmitting information. This is simplified, as in reality there will be flow control signals between the devices as well. In the code, you can send information and then wait on the other side to respond. Or if no response is needed, then you can continue to send information. The communication can be initiated from either side, and both need to be configured with the same parameters to be able to understand what the other is saying. Also, you can normally only have two devices connected between a pair of UART ports. Now to look at SPI. We still need an equivalent of the transmit, this time called MOSI, M-O-S-I, main out, secondary in, and MISO, MISO, main in, secondary out. Unlike the UART, where these cross, these are referred to the same name at both sides. The transmission is synchronous, so this also needs an additional clock signal as well, which is an additional connection. Whereas with the UART, it is normally half duplex, SPI is full duplex, so we'll send data in both directions simultaneously. There are pros and cons between these different protocols. While SPI can transmit data faster, That's not so important for the example I'm using. Important factors would be simplicity when programming, the UART serial is easier, or the ability to communicate with multiple devices, which SPI does. If you only need one device, then it may be easy to stick with UART, but if you want multiple devices, then SPI is a good choice. You may also want to consider that SPI uses 4 digital ports. The serial only uses 2. But of the serial ports, those are also used to update the code. So it's usually better not to use them except for serial communications. Another option is I2C, which uses the 2 ports that are normally used for analog inputs. I won't be covering those in this video, but hopefully add a video on that in future. This diagram shows how you can connect multiple secondary devices to a single main device. We'll only be using one secondary device in this example, but this shows 3. As you can see, the 3 lines MOSI, MISO and SCLK are shared, but each of the secondary devices uses a separate secondary select or chip select pin. The next thing to consider is the voltage difference between the Raspberry Pi and the Arduino. The Raspberry Pi GPIO works at 3.3 volts, whereas the Arduino Uno is at 5 volts. In the case of signals going from the Raspberry Pi to the Arduino, they should be okay. The minimum high voltage into the Arduino is 3 volts. However, in the reverse direction, on the MOSI port, then the output will be between 4.2 and 5 volts, which is too high for the Raspberry Pi. Some people have successfully connected the Raspberry Pi direct to the Uno, but I would advise to use a level shifter between the Raspberry Pi and the Arduino. This can safely convert the voltage between 3.3 volts and 5 volts. I've used the Adafruit 4-channel bidirectional logic level converter. Although it's designed for I2C, it can be used for SPI up to 2 MHz. An alternative is to run the Arduino or the 18Mega328P processor at a lower voltage. On the Freeduino I have used for the demonstration, it has an option to switch to 3.3 volts. Or you can create your own Arduino-like project using the 18Mega328P, and I've shown examples of this in an earlier video. Here I'm showing the test setup I used. This has the logic level converter to convert the voltages. I've connected LED outputs to some of the digital pins to test the digital outputs. I've actually used an LED bar graph and resistor array for convenience, but they could just be standard LEDs. I've also used the other spare digital port as an input, and I've used a variable resistor for the analog input to measure different voltages. This setup is going to allow me to demonstrate digital inputs and outputs as well as an analog input. The SPI protocol only covers the transmission of the data over the wire. It doesn't provide a protocol explaining about the data that is transmitted. I've therefore created my own protocol or set of rules which define how to pass information. As the data is transmitted a byte at a time, I've used the individual bits for different parts. Looking at the outgoing byte from the Raspberry Pi to the Arduino, looking at the least significant bit, which is on the right-hand side first, the first 4 bits will be the address of the digital or analog port. The next bit determines if the pin being referenced is digital or analog, then whether to read the request or write to the pin. Next, the value to write out, which applies for digital on and off. I haven't included PWM in this. Finally, the most significant bit changes how the rest of the information is used. If that is set to 1, then the rest of the bits are handled differently. And that's used so that we can send null codes or just to check whether the SPI device is responding. To get the relevant information from the byte, then I'll be using bitmasks. On this diagram, I've added the bitmasks used as hexadecimal values. For example, to get the address of the pin number, then the mask 0x0f is used, and that gives the value of the pin. See if it's a digital or analog pin, then use the mask 0x10. And if the output is 0, then it's a digital, otherwise it's analog. A similar thing is used for the other pins. I'll now show some parts of the code. To get the full code, then there's a link in the description and on the Penguin Tutor website. On the Arduino, then I've used the SPI library. The setup code needs the MISO port as an output, which sets it as a secondary device. Then it sets the appropriate bits on the SPI control register, SPCR. In this case, I'm polling the SPI registers to see if there's been an update. The alternative is to use interrupt-based messaging. There's pros and cons to each, but I think polling works better for this example. This is the main code included in the loop function. Note there is a big chunk of code in the middle, which is just shown as a comment. This is where the logic for handling the protocol is added. The SPI status registers are checked. This if condition will be met when the full byte is received. At that point, the data is a byte in the SPI data register. To send data back, then that same register needs to be updated with the reply. The Arduino will receive and send data at the same time, but because the protocol works by responding to a request from the Raspberry Pi, then as long as the response is included before the next byte is received, then it can treat this as if it was being sent one at a time. The Raspberry Pi has the job of starting communications and handling the values that are sent back to it. Many of the examples you will find using the C programming language, but I've instead created this in Python. It uses the SPI dev library. This is the code used to set up the communications. The SPI bus 0 refers to the SPI connections available on the GPIO, and the device 0 refers to chip enable port 0. If you wanted to use an additional secondary device, then you could use device 1 to refer to chip enable 1. It then creates an SPI instance and sets its maximum speed to 1 MHz. This code then sets up the communication with the Arduino. It first sends the byte 0x80, which the Arduino should echo back. It then uses the SPI xfer2 method, which is the transfer method that works with the Arduino. As the data is full-duplex, it will receive data from the Arduino at the same time as it sends data. At this stage, the Arduino hasn't put anything into the data register, so that byte is discarded. It then resends the same code so that that gets a response back. This way it can check the data has been received. You can then send code to and from the Arduino using the SPI xfer2 method. The demonstration code is available to download, which shows how the Arduino pins can be turned on and off and data read from the analog on digital pins on the Arduino. So, as you've seen, SPI can be used to communicate between a Raspberry Pi and an Arduino. It has high bandwidth and supports full duplex messaging, but it does come with a trade-off in terms of ease of use. It does also use quite a few of the digital pins that you may otherwise want to use for other purposes. It's worth considering for communication between a Raspberry Pi and an Arduino, particularly if you wanted to add multiple devices. I hope you found this useful. If so, please like and share the video. If you haven't already, so please subscribe to my channel for future videos on maker projects, including the Raspberry Pi and the Arduino.